Okay, I hope I'm live now. I am just logged in. Good evening, everyone. Okay, I'll wait for one minute more so that people can join, and then we'll start the session. I think about more than 100 people have already joined, so we can start the session since it was to start sharp at 5 o'clock. Okay, I would like to start by thanking Lois Witt, who took the initiative to organize this talk, and Mr. Shyam Sharma, renowned advocate of Delhi High Court, he spoke to me and requested that we should start something like this. I immediately agreed, and then Ms. Coplin Kaur, she's an active part of Lawyers Bed. She took the initiative, she organized everything, and Tarveen Singh assisted everybody. So thank you, all three of you. And my endeavor today will be to keep the talk very simple, because I am not addressing only the criminal lawyers. I would like that this talk should be useful for civil lawyers, for law students, and I got called from journalists who wanted to be part of this because they are the one who report crime. I got a call from Tihar jail officials, few of them who are friends on my Facebook, so they all wanted to be part of it. So let's have a general discussion about what criminal law is all about, how the crime is investigated, how the trials happen in the court. So I will start that. As far as I am concerned, my exposure to criminal law started very, very early, when I was in my teens, because I am a third generation criminal lawyer. My grandfather was a lawyer in Lahore High Court, he used to practice criminal law. My father is a great criminal lawyer in UP. So I remember when I was very, very young, I was in my school, maybe 8th or 9th standard, maybe much before that. Since my father was one of the top counsels in that area, so very often in the night, people used to approach him when the crime is committed. In that part of the world, there was a lot of crime at one point of time. So every night, somebody will approach him. And in case a request is made to draft the FIR, then he didn't have the stenographer, so he used to wake me up when I was very young, and I used to take the dictation from him. And I remember taking dictation in the most heinous offenses at that point of time. So my exposure, my association with criminal law started very, very early. And I think criminal law is very, very fascinating. And there are a few reasons for that. First is that criminal lawyers deal with the day-to-day problems at the grassroots level, and we deal with the dark side of the life. People approach us only when they are in trouble. They will certainly not approach us when they are having a great time. So criminal lawyers learn from the mistakes of others. We get an opportunity to understand how people commit mistakes, how they land in problems. Sometimes they are not at fault, but still they land in problems. So criminal lawyer is exposed to the ground realities. The criminal lawyers are exposed to what is happening in the society. Most of the people are totally oblivious of how the society functions and how a crime is committed. So I request a lot of my young colleagues to pick up criminal law, start practicing criminal law, and pick up this field. So
just a second, I don't know.
So, before I start and before I come on to the intricacies of investigation and criminal trial, I would like to introduce everybody with criminal manual. All criminal lawyers are aware of this book, and this is the Bible, this is Gita for a criminal lawyer. And my recommendation to everyone is pick up one book which should belong to you, not to anybody else. Because we criminal lawyers, we need this day in and day out. This is the foundation of the criminal justice system in our country. So we should have one book which belong to us, which belong to only that person, he or she, so that you can make your notes, so that you pick up this book and take out a particular provision. And if your note is there, it'll be very handy when you're in the court. So this is the most essential book for any criminal lawyer. Now, coming on to crime, what is crime? Crime is inevitable in any human society. You know, it's the oldest civilization, if you consider, there'll be some section of people who will always violate law, who will always violate some code of conduct which is prevailing in that society. And how paradoxical it may sound, there are some sociologists who say that crime to certain extent helps in promoting the social solidarity among the people. What does it mean? It means that when the crime is committed, people unite. People get together to fight that crime. And I can share a few instances with you, a few examples. Nirbhaya rape case is one example. When that incident happened in Delhi, people got together, there were protests, there were candle marches all around. And the result is what? The result is people fought the system. People came onto the roads and persuaded the government to rethink about the laws on rape. And ultimately, Dr. J.S. Verma, Justice J.S. Verma's committee was constituted, and the entire law on rape was revamped, was reconsidered. That's the power of people. So when crime takes place, people get together. Second example I would quote will be India against corruption. Now, when the corruption was at its peak, then a group is constituted, and I think there is, I hope I'm audible to everyone. Am I audible to everyone? Can you please write? Yes. So, India Against Corruption was a movement which started when the corruption was at its peak. And India Against Corruption, some people got together and they fought because of the corruption which is happening in the society. The result is what? Result is it created a political party. Just imagine a movement which results into formulation of a political party, party which is ruling Delhi today, party which is ruling Delhi for the second time. This is the power when people get together. And this happens, and in both the occasion which I have cited, it's because of a crime which was committed. So, crime is inevitable, it will happen, people will violate law. Now, how it has to be dealt with is the question today. Now, police has various functions to perform. The first function which they have to perform is detection and investigation of a crime. So, when the crime is committed, it has to be investigated. That's the job of the police. Second fundamental duty or function of the police is to prevent the crime. That crime should not happen in the society. So they have to make sure that the preventive action are taken against people who violate the law. And then third and the most important is the enforcement of variety of regulations. So three jobs: detection, investigation, prevention of crime, and then third and the most important is to make sure that the regulations are followed, like municipal laws, the traffic laws, for instance. Traffic police is part of the, you know, police community. They have to make sure that the traffic laws are followed, and if, you know, somebody violates it, then action should be taken against him. These are three principal functions of the police. Now, how the crime is investigated by the police is very important. What I will do is that I will be dividing my talk into two part: investigation and criminal trial. Once I complete investigation, I'll be sharing with you certain important landmark judgments so that you can note them down. And you can ask questions. Your questions will be noted by a member of the lawyer's wit, and they will be sending an email to me in the end. I'll read that email and then try to answer all the questions. So note down the judgment which I'll be citing. I'll be giving you 15-20 important judgments which are relevant for everybody. And then I'll answer the questions in the end. Okay, how the crime is investigated is all given in the Code of Criminal Procedure. So I'll explain to you in general term. When a crime is committed and is witnessed by someone or noticed by someone, or it has come into the knowledge of someone, then he or she goes and reports the crime to the police. And depending on the gravity of the crime, the action is taken. If it is a cognizable offense where police has the power to arrest immediately after the crime without warrant, the FIR is registered and FIR is recorded. The moment FIR is recorded, there is a person who is given that job of investigation. He is called investigating officer. So investigating officer is appointed. His job is to conduct investigation in that particular crime. Then he goes to the scene of crime. He inspects the scene of crime. He collects material, evidence. In case there are witnesses which are available, he will go and record statements of those witnesses. In case, if it's a case of murder, somebody has died, he will get the postmortem done. If somebody is injured, then he will get him medically examined and collects the medical evidence. So if it's a case of assault, then the medical evidence comes into the picture. If it is not a crime against body, if it is some other crime, then that material is collected by the investigating officer. And sometimes forensic investigation is done. Forensic material is taken, like for instance, some CCTV recording is found at the spot, then CCTV recording is downloaded, sent to a, you know, forensic expert, a report is called. So all this is done by the investigating officer. And in case he wants to arrest someone, then there is a separate chapter which deals with arrest. Then people are arrested, then they have legal rights for bail. I will deal with that separately. But let me conclude what IO has to do. IO has to collect material evidence and prepare a report. So that report is a report under Section 173. He prepares a report for prosecuting the accused person. If he completes investigation, doesn't find material against someone, he can close the case. So job of investigating officer is to find truth. Job of investigating officer is not to simply arrest someone and prosecute someone. Since police is an investigating agency which is independent, so their job is to conduct independent investigation, not to side with the complainant and bolster the case of the complainant. That's not the job of the investigating officer. So IO completes the investigation, files a report in the court. In the meantime, if I tell you about the arrest, then if the accused are known, then investigating officer arrests the person. When he arrests the person, within 24 hours of his arrest, it is his duty, it is a statutory duty to bring the accused to the court. And if he brings the accused to the court has to examine whether the arrest is legal or not, whether the arrest was required or not. And very often the investigating agency want that the accused should be given in their custody. So their custody means that is called police custody. So accused is authorized to be taken by the police for the purposes of investigation. And that custody has to be authorized by the court. So that's a very important duty of the court. Very often we see that the magistrates on a drop of a hat give the custody to the police. I remember, good old days when I was with my father in early 90s, mid 90s. I have seen magistrate refusing even remand in as serious as murder case. Because for remand, you have to show how this person is involved in a case. So that is the kind of scrutiny which the magistrate has to do. Magistrate has to authorize the detention, and before that detention is authorized, he has to satisfy himself what is the material against him. So in case police custody is sought, then there is a limit of 15 days that from the date of arrest till the 15th day, the custody can be changed. The custody can be given to the police. But beyond 15 days, the custody has to be a judicial custody. It's a very, very vital aspect of the matter which any criminal lawyer would like to understand, because very often the lawyers are engaged to challenge the police custody. So we must understand the laws with regard to police custody. Delhi High Court has rules with regard to custody. CRPC deals, 167 deals with the custody of the accused person. And there are various judgments which I will share with you after the aspect of investigation is concluded. So if the accused is in custody, it is the duty of investigating officer to conclude the investigation in 60 or 90 days, depending on the nature of the crime. If the crime is less than, if the crime is punishable for less than 10 years, it is 60 days. Beyond that, it's 90 days. If the investigation is not concluded within 60 or 90 days, then there's a provision of automatic bail, which is called default bail. If the investigating officer commits a default in furnishing his investigation report, the bail will be granted by the magistrate. It works like an axe. It's an indefeasible right of the accused. Again, there are some judgments which I'll be sharing with you later on custody as well as on default bail. Now, once the charge sheet is filed, once investigation is concluded, charge sheet is filed in the court, then the job of investigating agency is over as far as investigation is concerned. But please examine a situation where accused is arrested, he spends 60 or 90 days in the custody, and only a part charge sheet is filed with regard to this particular accused, but the investigating officer feels that it's a larger conspiracy and he wants more accused to be arrested. Then there is a power of further investigation which is given to the investigating agency. That power of further investigation is under section 173(8). The court, the IO can say that, sorry, with regard to this particular accused person, I have concluded the investigation. As far as others, I am still continuing and I need time. So very often the court grants time to the investigating agency. So this is one charge sheet against one person. Investigation is still going on. If it is completed, charge sheet can be filed against others or a closure can be filed against others. This is a very normal practice considering the magnitude of the offenses which are being investigated by the police agencies, particularly in money laundering cases, where number of accused are much more, where the investigation is very, very wide, where documentary evidence is very, very huge, which you can't conclude in 60 or 90 days, then of course the time is given to the investigating agency to further investigate beyond 60, 90 days, and they take their own sweet time. So once the charge sheet is filed, it is now the matter between the court and the accused. The investigating agency goes to a prosecutor. Prosecutor looks at the report, examines the report, can guide the investigating agency that these are the loopholes in your investigation. Please plug the loopholes before you go to the court. So the assistance of a prosecutor is taken at that stage, and then charge sheets are filed. Charge sheets are examined by the court before the cognizance is taken. And in certain cases where some kind of sanction is required, which is mandatory, the sanction is sought. And when sanction is taken, then it is examined by the court and cognizance is taken. So the court, now the trial begins. So now from the police, from the domain of the police, we come into the domain of the court. So I'll just repeat it. Crime committed, investigating officer appointed, he has massive powers of investigation, he goes to the spot, collects material, and in case required, arrest the accused, record the statement of the witnesses, compile the evidence which he has collected, and place it before the court for consideration. Okay, this is a very simple process, but it takes a long time, because the expert reports take its own time. The laboratories which we have, the forensic labs which we have very few number of good forensic labs. So when the IU has to take the report with regard to a voice sample, for instance, there is a case of interception of telephone conversation, then a sample has to be taken, sample has to be matched with the conversation. In case there's a letter, then the handwriting has to be matched. Sometimes the investigating agency requires tools of investigation, like narco analysis test, like lie detector test. There are many tests which are tools of investigation. They may not be admissible in evidence, but police can make use of these tools to gather information. And now, just one more aspect of arrest I would like to address on, and then I'll come on to the court proceedings. So arrest, as I told you, if accused is arrested, within 24 hours investigation should be concluded, or else he has to be brought to the court. Court will authorize the detention, and police detention can only be for 15 days. Now, during this period, accused has a right to file regular bail because he's already in custody. He has a right to file bail. So he will approach the court and satisfy the court that, look, I am in custody. IO has arrested me. I am not required for further investigation because he has already examined me. My custodial interrogation is over. So release me on bail. He will try to satisfy the court that he has deep roots in the society. He will not tamper with the evidence, and he will not violate any terms and condition. Will give surety whatever is wanted by the court so that he is released on bail. So bail is a very, very significant aspect of a lawyer's, criminal lawyer's practice, because a successful lawyer is the one who gets bail at the earliest. The success and failure of a lawyer depends on how early you can get bail. So bail applications are filed under section 437 and 439 of CRPC when they are in custody. There are various judgments, and there are judgments after judgments under when and how the bail should be granted, what are the parameters, and whether bail can be, you know, cancelled once granted or not. And sometimes what happens is that the accused, who is not available at the spot, who's not arrested by the police but has an apprehension of arrest, he goes to the court and asks for anticipatory bail. And anticipatory bail is a provision which protects the liberty of the accused before arrest. And that again is a very, very significant part of our practice, where lot of anticipatory bails are filed when there's an apprehension of arrest, and the bail applications go till Supreme Court. Starts from Sessions Court, then High Court, then Supreme Court, and you must have witnessed in these in the last about 6 months to 1 year, there's so many arrests which have taken place in SFIU cases, PMLA cases, and the matters have gotten Supreme Court. Again, it's a massive field, and there are so many judgments. I'll try to share few with you on bail also. So these are the nuances of criminal law pertaining to investigation. So I can share with you few judgments which you can note down. I told one of my colleagues to prepare me a list. Give me a list of. Okay, so with regard to the registration of FIR, now what happens is very often complaints are filed to the police and they don't register the investigation. They don't register the FIR. And of course, the complainant is quite aggrieved that why the FIR has not been registered. There's a law on registration of FIR. There are five judges of the Supreme Court have decided in Lalita Kumari's case that it is the bounden duty of the investigating officer to register the FIR whenever it is filed. He can conduct a preliminary inquiry, but he must register the FIR. If the complaint is found to be false, then he can prosecute the complainant. So Lalita Kumari's case is of 2014, volume 2, SCC, page 1. I'm doing this because some of my colleagues said that you must give judgments so that, everybody has the access and they can read the judgment and they get, some benefit out of it. Now, another aspect which is very important with regard to registration of FIR is that when the FIR is not registered, in spite of requesting the SHO or requesting the senior, police official, the complainant has a right to go to the court. Complainant has a right to go to a magistrate and request that the FIR is not being registered in spite of complaint being filed. So kindly direct. So magistrate directs the police to register. There is one significant judgment of Priyanka Srivastava versus State of UP. This is 2015, volume 6, SCC, page 285. Priyanka Srivastava versus State of UP. The first one was Lalita Kumari versus Government of UP, 2014, 2 SCC, page 1. And another very significant judgment is Sakeri Vasu, where magistrate has the power to supervise the investigation. Which is conducted by the IO is supervised by the magistrate. The magistrate has to see what is happening, whether proper investigation is conducted or not. That is Sakeri Vasu versus State of UP, 2001, volume 6, SCC, page 181. Okay, and another very significant judgment on arrest. As I told you, IO has to decide whether to arrest an accused or not. So there is a law of the Honorable Supreme Court which says when the offense is punishable only up to 7 years, you decide in advance whether you would like to arrest the accused or not. Section 41 of CRPC. So there is a judgment given by Supreme Court which lays down the guidelines. You just can't arrest anyone for committing an offense up to 7 years. Just like that, you have to satisfy your papers. You have to reflect why do you want to arrest him. That judgment is Arnesh Kumar versus State of Bihar. That is 2014-8 SCC 273. 2014-8 SCC 273, Arnesh Kumar judgment, the power of the IO to arrest and how it is controlled and circumscribed. Another judgment which is important for everyone should be T.T. Anthony versus State. This shows that there can't be two FIRs with regard to same transaction. If one FIR is registered, there can't be second FIR with regard to the same facts. So T.T. Anthony versus State of Kerala, 2001, 6 SCC, page 181. Again, a very, very significant judgment. These are judgments which we use
almost daily in the court. Any good, busy criminal lawyer will be reading this day in and day out. Every week he'll be citing this judgment. One more important judgment on the fact that the police custody can be only for the first 15 days. The landmark judgment of 1992, Supreme Court, which is CBI versus Anupam J. Kulkarni. 1992-3-SCC-141. This is the first judgment which laid down the law that the police can ask for custody only in the first 15 days of the arrest, not beyond that. A very significant judgment. I had stated something about if the investigation is not conducted within 60 or 90 days, there will be a default bail. The landmark judgment on that point is Rakesh Paul versus State of Assam. Rakesh Paul versus State of Assam, 2017, 15 SCC 67. Now, this judgment says that if the charge sheet is not filed within time, then there has to be an automatic bail. Even if the accused does not file the application for bail, does not exercise that right, still it is the duty of the magistrate to release him on bail. So a very significant judgment which had thrown light on a lot of grey areas. So these are few judgments with regard to the investigation. Now, before I come on to the trial, there is one very important aspect you must understand. There are three and four important basic principles of criminal law, of criminal jurisprudence. First is the presumption of innocence. Now we are in the court. The investigation is over. When the trial starts, now we have to see how the justice system pertaining to courts work. Four things you must keep in mind. One is presumption of innocence, that accused is presumed to be innocent until proven guilty. Please keep that in mind when you strategize something for a case. Two, that burden of proof is always on the state. Burden of proof is always on the police. They have to prove their case. They have to establish the case beyond reasonable doubt, not the accused. It is their job. The only exception is there are some statutes which are framed by the government, some laws which are passed by the government, where they make it mandatory, where they create a provision and shift the burden of proof onto the accused. In IPC, there are only two offenses, abetment to suicide and dowry death, where if certain things are fulfilled, then the burden shifts, not otherwise. Otherwise, in every case, the burden of proof is on the state. Okay. Third principle is right to remain silent. Article 20, clause 3. No person accused of an offense shall be compelled to be a witness against himself. So right of silence is a very, very sacrosanct constitutional right available to an accused. Third, fourth is double jeopardy. Article 20, clause 2, that a person cannot be tried and convicted for the same offense twice. Right? These four things you have to keep in mind when you go to the court, when you fight any litigation on behalf of an accused. Right? Now, when the charge sheet is filed, now we are in the domain of the court, how the trials takes place. Now we all know the CRPC will tell everybody that there are different procedure of trials for different offenses depending on the gravity. If there is a minor offense, there will be a summons trial. If it is a bit graver, there will be a warrant trial. If it is really grave, then it will be a session trial. Session trial is the next level. So summons trials are trials which are quick, which happen early. The procedure is such where it should conclude early. Warrant trials happen before a magistrate. Summon and warrant both are tried by magistrate. Session trials are tried by session courts. So there are three different procedures which are given in the Act. There are three different chapters. I can give you the chapter. The session trial is given in chapter 20, warrant in chapter 19, and someone's trial in chapter number 18. So 18, 19, 20 are very important. Now, when the matter goes to the court, the charge sheet is filed. Now, the work of the honorable judge starts. He has to apply his mind. He is not bound by the opinion of the investigating officer. I always argue on this. We all criminal lawyers, good criminal lawyers, have to argue this, tell the court it's not binding on you. Please apply your mind. And you should come to the conclusion whether this is a case which requires trial or not. So this is the stage of arguments on charge. If it is summons trial, warrant trial, it will be tried by magistrate. If it is session trial, it goes to the session. It will be, first it will be filed before a magistrate. He'll commit it to a higher court. He will apply his mind, takes cognizance, send it to the sessions court. So session court, higher court, the magistrate is a lower court. Their job is to now frame the charge. Now there are hundreds of good points which are involved here, very, very, very interesting propositions. What will be the jurisdiction of the court at the time of framing of charge? Whether the documents which are in favor of accused can be filed by him or not? These are all finer issues which we will take in the next level. Today we are confining this discussion purely on general principles, but later on I will sit with the organizers, we'll pick up issues, various issues in the trial, and then try to go and, you know, discuss them in detail. So, but in general, now I'm discussing with you the trial procedure. The jurisdiction of court at the time of framing of charges, when the judge feels that the case has grave, that there is a grave suspicion that accused has committed the offense, then he will frame the charge so that the trial starts. Earlier, 10 years back, 15 years back, a lot of discharge used to take place. Nowadays, the discharge are very, very limited. It's all the mindset of the judges. The mindset of judges, the jurisprudence changes with the changes in the society. So nowadays, the thought process of the judges is, even though there are two views possible, but let there be a trial. At least the prosecution will be happy the trial is conducted. And in case he has to be acquitted, the accused will be acquitted. My personal view is that is wrong. I always feel, and sometimes we have to argue with so much of intensity, try to convince the court, please, this is a case where we should not waste the judicial time. This is a case where accused deserve to be discharged. I mean, there are cases where in murder cases, accused have been discharged. In conspiracy cases, the accused have been discharged at such a preliminary stage, but not now. It's very seldom we find, discharge nowadays. Maybe the time will change. But as of now, the discharge are very less. So the trial starts here. The prosecution witnesses are brought by the prosecutor. They are examined. Then they are cross-examined by the defense counsels. And the trial starts. Two very significant provisions of law, which are general, which you all should know, is that beyond the charge sheet, if additional material is required to be examined, the prosecution has a power to do it. Sometimes they recall their witnesses. Sometimes new witnesses are called. Sometimes new evidence has to be brought. There's a provision under 311. Just note down that, read CRPC, you will understand what I'm saying. Then there is a provision which is very important, is 319. Suppose charge sheet is filed only against few accused persons. But during the course of trial, additional evidence comes. Then the court has the power to call an additional accused, an additional person to face the trial. 319 CRPC. Right? 311, 319, you must understand. And then with regard to cross-examination, We have to have a session on the Evidence Act, how cross-examination is conducted, what is the relevance, what's the relevance of 161 statement. That's a completely different domain. So evidence starts, evidence concluded. Once the evidence is concluded, the accused is asked to say, not just imagine, see the plight of the accused, starting from FIR, investigation, charge sheet, charge, evidence. In our criminal justice system, now for the first time, the accused is asked, please tell us what you have to say. Right? Now, this period of recording of evidence takes considerably long period of time. It's a very, very long time. In our country, we still use the typewriters, we still use the computer to type. Unlike many other countries, I had an opportunity to conduct a trial in Greece, where everything was digitally recorded. I remember the day when the evidence was recorded, all witnesses were called in the court on one single day. 20 witnesses standing outside the courtroom. The witness is called, he's standing in front of the court. The court is asking questions. Lawyers are asking questions. Cross-examination is being done. Nothing is typewritten. Everything is digitally recorded. So within 15 minutes, 20 minutes, the evidence is concluded. And the transcript is prepared subsequently. So I have seen 10 to 15 witnesses examined on one single day because they are digitally recorded. But in India, unfortunately, we still use the same system. The typist type line by line, and then proof checking is done, and then ultimately signature if the witness, you know, the evidence goes in 30, 40, 50 pages, goes on, it takes all the time. So we have to improvise. We must use the technology to our advantage. We must make sure that we expedite the trial. The trial period should not take 7 to 10 years. Sometimes it takes a lot of times. Considering the fact that the bail jurisprudence has undergone a change, it's very difficult to get bail. Very often you will see cases where accused are not granted bail for the entire trial and for the entire appeal, and ultimately he is acquitted. Imagine a situation. I remember R.K. Sharma, that famous Shivani Bhatnagar murder case. 5 years, 5.5, 6 years in trial court, no bail. 3.5, 4 years of appeal in high court, 9 years, and ultimately acquitted. Pappu Yadav from Bihar, his bail was rejected by the Supreme Court 9 times. Ultimately acquitted. So we have to reduce the time period for the trial. We must say, because the word session, it's very significant to understand. Session trial derives from the word session, means when the trial starts, it should be open, it should be concluded in a session. You start today, there should be a day-to-day trial and it should be concluded. We'll be able to achieve a lot, but we can't achieve it. In today's circumstance, if we see the situation today, even though there are many judges who have very limited trials with them, but still they are unable to conclude it within the shortest period of time. Now, the statement of accused is recorded under 313, and accused is asked about the evidence. Whatever evidence is brought by the prosecutor is put to him, and now he has to give his response. So he has an option to examine himself. He can come and give his own evidence, and or he can bring the defense evidence. So he is given that opportunity. Like in a case of plea of alibi, if an accused says that I was not present at the spot, I have been falsely implicated. Now his turn has come to produce his evidence to show. If the crime has taken place in Delhi, he will come and show that I was not in Delhi at that point of time. I was, say, in Bombay or Calcutta or Madras. He'll bring his evidence to show that he's been falsely implicated. Or for that matter, any other evidence to prove his innocence, he can bring at the stage of defense evidence. And then the arguments take place, right? Then oral and written arguments take place. And then finally, the judgment is passed. And once the judgment is passed, whether it's acquittal or conviction, we can always challenge it to a higher court. From magistrate, we go to session. From session, we go to the high court, and then so on and so forth. Now, there are two, three very important aspects. I'll quickly conclude that, then I'll see in case they have sent me an email with regard to your questions. Then I can answer those questions. Yes, I've got it. Copeland sent me. Okay, so there are two, three important aspects which you must read in CRPC. First is the provision of plea bargaining. We all must understand what is plea bargaining, although it's not very prevalent in India at the moment. In US, yes, plea bargaining is very successful. The object of plea bargaining is to remove the overcrowding of cases and also to save the judicial time. But not very prevalent, because in plea bargaining, we have to admit our guilt. We have to admit our crime. So we are not ready. The bar is not ready. The law, the accused are not ready to even accept that they have committed the crime. They want acquittal. So not many people opt for plea bargaining. Then there is an issue of grant of pardon, tender of pardon of the accused. 306, right? So the prosecuting agency has the power to ask for pardon of one of the accused in case he comes forward in the court and gives a larger disclosure. He throws light on the crime. He gives more material to the court which the investigating agency could not collect. So that is one provision which very often CBI uses it. Delhi police, normal state police, they don't advocate or they don't follow 306, but CBI does it very often. And the third and important is compensation. This entire objective of criminal justice system is one, to punish the criminal; second, to give justice to the victim. So therefore, if there is only punishment, no justice to the victim, it will be considered to be a futile process. So in every case, the court has to do justice, also satisfy the victim. That's why the definition of victim was changed. I think somewhere in 2016-17, the definition of victim was broadened up. And, a lot of people who are affected by the crime are also covered in that. So their compensation is also very important. Now, I've just got an email. I think they have prepared questions. So I'll read the question and I'll try to answer it. Is there a due process for appointing an IO? If yes, not followed, can it lead to mistrial by Mr. Siddhant Singh? Well, IO is appointed at the police station level. Normally, it is appointed by the SHO, because the IOs are from the level of sub-inspector to inspector, depending on the crime. And also sometimes a senior official, if the statute prescribes. Like in IT Act, Information Technology Act, the IO has to be a senior level officer of the ACP or DSP. In Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribe Act, also the IO has to be at a senior level. But the appointment of IO normally is in routine, and they keep on changing also. It's not necessary that every time the IO says, the IO changes, because if the IO is transferred from one police station to the other, then he's changed. So there is no due process which is there for appointment of IO, right? Course of action available in case IO fails to file report in statutory time by Manvi Gola. This I think I have already addressed. If the charge sheet is not filed within time and accused is arrested, then it deserves to be released on mandatory bail under 167.2. I've already given you a judgment of that. So that is one case. So I think that answers. How to calculate the time of default bail? This is by Mr. Jatin Sehgal. The 60 days and 90 days are calculated on the basis of the period of custody. Now, if the accused is arrested, say for instance today, and produced before the magistrate today, then we'll exclude this day. But if he's arrested yesterday and produced today before a magistrate, then the counting starts from today till the 60th day evening. The charge sheet has to be filed. If it is not filed, then default bail will lie. And if the 60th day is a holiday, for instance, 60th day is a Sunday, then the charge sheet can be filed on Monday. There are some judgments that because it was a holiday, 60th day is a holiday, therefore the IO could not file. Therefore, if he files on Monday, it was accepted by the court. And then can accused seek further investigation and show some documents to show his or her innocence by Karan B. Singh? Well, there are conflicting judgments. There are some judgments which say that it's only police which has the power to conduct investigation. But these directions are passed in writ jurisdiction or in 482 by a higher court. Magistrate does not have the power to direct if the accused files an application. But accused, if he goes to the high court, files a writ petition under the constitution, says that my article 21 is violated because there is a gross violation or the investigation is not properly conducted. There are gaps in the investigation. He points out some relevant facts. Very often I have seen the high court intervenes and directs further investigation under writ jurisdiction, not before the magistrate. What remedies does informant complainant has in case police files a closure report in the court by Vipin Singh Rajput? Mr. Rajput, when you go through the CRPC, you will see that if the closure report is filed, the closure report has to be accepted by the magistrate. If it is not accepted by the magistrate, then he, magistrate, can on his own say that I don't accept. But before that, he gives a notice to the complainant. So complainant has a right, complainant will be called. No case can be closed without hearing the complainant. Complainant will be called. He will be permitted to file a protest petition. Protest petition will be looked into by the court and then a decision is taken. So complainant is never remedyless. Complainant has options which he can exercise by filing protest petition and seeking cognizance in the matter. Section 302, can the period for filing the charge sheet be kept in abeyance qua the COVID-19 impact with respect to limitation by Paramesh Bali? Well, I don't think so, because police is still working, although they are not conducting normal investigation. About 4-5 days back, I was approached on the same proposition of law. 60th day was falling on 14th. I guided them, please file the application on 14th. If the charge sheet is not filed, then we will press for bail. On my advice, the briefing counsel went, filed the application under 167.2. But when we went to the court, we found the charge sheet was already filed 4 days back. I don't think the police will take that risk, particularly in heinous offences, not to file the charge sheet in time. But yes, in case charge sheet is not filed, although this issue is never raised, never considered by any court, that because of COVID-19, the charge sheet is not filed within time. But when a question like this is considered by the court, then they will consider Article 21, that why one person should languish in jail just because the investigation is not happening. So according to me, he will get the benefit. What is the general term of maximum arrest until a sentence decision is passed by the court? What is the general term of maximum arrest? I don't understand this. Let me read the others in the meantime. Are the anticipatory bail matter of public record? If you read the Delhi High Court rules, what are the material which are of public record? I argued recently before a court, I don't want to name the accused. In that case, we told the court that don't give the investigative material, charge sheet and documents, to a third party, including the journalist, because this is a matter which is confidential between the court, the prosecutor and the accused. Why should third party be given the documents? I'm talking about charge sheet and documents. My argument was upheld by the court. There's a detailed judgment passed that yes, these documents should not be shared with the third party because they are outside the purview of CRPC. Coming back on your anticipatory bail applications, those bail applications are not public record. Delhi High Court says in criminal matters, the public record, the record of the case will become public only when it is disposed of, when the judgment is passed. When the judgment is passed, anybody can take copies. That's the High Court rule. It's very clear. Any good judgment on the aspect of transit bail, Mr. Pradeep Khatri, the transit bail is given when accused is arrested in a state or in a district, but the investigation is conducted outside. For instance, crime committed in Calcutta, FIR in Calcutta, the accused is resident of Delhi and he seeks transit bail. This is, I'm talking about anticipatory bail. Transit anticipatory bail, please protect the accused so that he goes to Calcutta and applies for anticipatory bail. Very often, time is given to the accused person to go and seek bail in that court, depending on the distance. If it is UP or Haryana, maybe 3 or 4 days. If it's Calcutta, maybe 10 days. Now, this transit bail is also important when accused is arrested in Delhi for a crime committed in Calcutta. The law is that he should be produced before the magistrate. Magistrate will authenticate the travel of the accused from Delhi to Calcutta. There we have an option of filing bail and saying that he will cooperate. You know, all those grounds of bail can be agitated before a magistrate. Magistrate can be convinced, and very often I have seen transit bail is given. He is released then and there and he's told to go and approach that court within week 10 days. There are some judgment we can share. I can share with Pradeep Khatri later. If IU has submitted incomplete document, false statement under 161, what remedy does the victim have as per CRPC? You're talking about remedy vis-a-vis the victim, okay? IU has to, if IU does not perform his job well and does something to protect an accused, because he's doing a statutory investigation, if he fails into that, deliberately or otherwise, he can be prosecuted under IPC. There are offenses in which you can take action against the investigating officer. In fact, during COVID-19, I argued a case last week for a senior police official. Allegation against him by the same, in fact, the same situation is that he had not conducted the investigation properly. So therefore, action should be taken and court directs registration of FIR against the investigating officer. I got that order stayed from Supreme Court, from the High Court last week, but there were some other grounds over there. Yes, IU can be prosecuted for malafide investigation. Section 239, can any document be produced by the accused showing his innocence and whether the magistrate will consider the same in discharge of accused? If so, any judgment? SCI Karan Suneja. Yes, Mr. Suneja, there are various judgments in that respect that accused can file documents at the stage of framing of charge which are unimpeachable in nature. There are various judgments. I'll have to open this. I think there is a judgment of Nityanand versus State Supreme Court judgment of 2018, which says that even at the stage of framing of charge, the accused can bring his material if it is unimpeachable, if that material cannot be challenged. Suppose there is some public record, suppose there is a judicial record, suppose there is a record which is with the government, there is a public document from ROC, for instance. All those can be filed even at that stage. 239 is stage of charge. 2 FIR on same fact can be registered, but if multiple persons are affected by same act of one person, can separate FIR be allowed to be registered against that person by such multiple persons? There are again conflicting judgments. I argued the same point in the year 2005, about 15 years back, in the case of finance company, where there are multiple accused persons, multiple victims all over the country. We went to Supreme Court, says club everything, make one case. The Supreme Court said, sorry, every investor has a right to file a case. It's a different crime, different cause of action, different FIRs can be filed. But according to my personal experience, the economic offences wing very often club the number of witnesses, file one charge sheet in the court. It's easier to prosecute the accused person. Okay, question number 13. Can the court frame charge of 302 IPC when in the charge sheet police has leveled the charge of 304 IPC? Ms. Shashi Sakshi Kakkar. Yes, madam, very much possible. As I told you, that the opinion of the IO is not binding on the court. Opinion of the IO is 302. If the magistrate or the sessions court comes to a conclusion that there is no material to show that there was a intention to kill, there was only knowledge, then even charge under 304 can be filed. That depends on the court. Can magistrate ask for further investigation before charge? Yes, Mr. Himanshu Sharma, of course. The there are three options which are available with the court, a very old H.S. Bain's judgment and Tularam judgment with regard to jurisdiction of the magistrates. When a closure is filed, there are three options: accepted, rejected, and asked for further investigation. But further investigation, suppose the IO himself comes and makes a request, further investigation can be allowed even before the charges are framed. And as I told you before, that in writ jurisdiction, if the grievance is made by the accused, then I have seen few cases where the court has intervened and court says, no, you investigate these parts, these points which have not been investigated, and file a report. So it can be done. Can an application under 294 CRPC be filed at the time of argument on charge? Mr. Baljeet Singh Dheer Saab is there. Yeah. Report of cert, this is 290, no formal proof of certain documents. So, Mr. Dheer, actually this 294 is an exercise which is done at that stage itself when the argument on charge are happening, where they say that no formal, in fact it starts after the charges are framed, when the trial starts. So application can be filed only during the time of trial when the formal proof of a particular document is not required. The objective of 294 is to curtail the time of the trial, not to waste the time of the court. So just like in civil cases, we have admission denial. We can't have admission denial here, but we can take proof of certain documents which are admitted documents so that we don't waste time in calling witnesses and getting them exhibited. If the accused denies the charge and proves that the complaint has been withdrawn by the prosecutor, can the case be closed? Priyanka Batra. Well, the withdrawal of prosecution is under section 321 of CRPC, and 321 is very, very clear that it is a prerogative only of the prosecutor to withdraw the prosecution. Although the government can take the initiative, but ultimately it is the discretion of the prosecutor. The prosecutor can always say, I am withdrawing the prosecution, and the case can be withdrawn. It can happen at any stage. The language of the the provision of law itself will say. Now, next set of question number 17. Mr. Rajesh Narang is talking about section 188, which is now being, invoked nowadays for violating social distancing all over the country. 188 IPC is used very often when the order of the public servant is violated, right? Suppose there is a curfew order, it's violated. There's an order, you don't enter into this area. If somebody bars in, somebody trespasses, 188 is. 188, there are very few prosecutions. 188 is punishable, I think, for 6 months or so. Let me see. So I don't think it will be of very grave consequence. Disobedience to order duly promulgated by public servant, it is punishable for one month with fine which makes sense. It's a compoundable offense, basically. Should be compoundable. Just see whether in the chart it is compoundable or not. If it is compoundable, may not be, because public servant is involved. Let's see section 320. 320 CRPC gives the list of cases which are compoundable. 188 is not there. So, I think the trial will happen where you have to prove your innocence, that you have not done it deliberately. So, that's the best which can happen in the trial, and you get an acquittal or discharge. Okay, Mr. Avnish Kashyap says, what's the difference between acquittal and discharge? Discharge at a preliminary stage before the trial when there is no grave suspicion, without the trial, accused is discharged, and acquittal happens only when the trial is concluded and the case is not proved beyond reasonable doubt. In which stage of trial the plea bargaining can be availed? Mr. Sanchit Gupta, plea bargaining is permitted only in those offences that are punishable up to 7 years. Please read section chapter number 21A, section 265A onwards. You can read that and see in which category of offences it's permitted. And then last question number 20th is, police is registering FIR under 188 for those violating lockdown. Whether the registration of such FIR is permissible or not as per the scheme of CRPC. I think it's very much permissible, Mr. Shadman Siddiqui. If you have few clients, you can conduct trial, try to prove their innocence, saying that they have not violated. FIR is only a prima facie satisfaction, doesn't mean that the case is proved beyond reasonable doubt. You have to see if in case there's a violation of the order, it's an order by a public servant. So therefore, it has to be scrupulously followed. If it is not followed, then the accused can be prosecuted. But yes, it's a trial. You have to prove your innocence during the course of trial. Another set of 5 questions. Whether accused can demand investigation conducted by any other agency like CBI? Accused can demand investigation. Yes, of course, by Abha Dubey. The CBI is Delhi Special Police Establishment, and Delhi Special Police Establishment is originated, constituted by an act, which is called Delhi Special Police Establishment Act. CBI, that's the real name of CBI. Now, CBI investigations happen only when the state gives the permission that CBI can investigate. So, if I go to the CBI, file an application, they may not accept it. But if a bank goes to the CBI, the CBI will accept it. So, the registration of regular cases by CBI is a different ballgame altogether. But if an aggrieved person wants that his case should be investigated by CBI, then he has to go to the higher court. The power lies only with the High Court and Supreme Court. High Court under Article 226 and Supreme Court under Article 32. Only those constitutional powers can be invoked for transfer of investigation or even for registration of FIR with the CBI. Please broadly explain the procedure of admonition, so and so. How does court address the custodial violence? Divyani Singh, can FIR be filed after conviction by taking further acts of accused based on first FIR? Okay, with regard to custodial violence, there are many incidents which have been investigated by the police where the violence has reached death of an individual. But very often when the custody is given by the court to the police, the courts direct the police to get them medically examined. So if the police custody is given to any police officer, direction is before you take the accused out of the courtroom, you must give an undertaking that he will be taken to a hospital. So there is a hospital document examination. And when he's brought back to the court, then again, there has to be a medical examination. So courts very often make sure that the accused are medically examined before they are produced and again when they are produced. So that's the precaution which the court takes to make sure that no third degree is given to the accused persons. Now, these are broadly few questions which were asked and I have answered almost all of them. And I think I had a great time. The time has come to, put an end to this. But this was the general idea of how the investigation is conducted, charge sheet is filed. And we'll certainly come back and we'll have a more, specific provision, specific discussion where we can go in depth about those, propositions of law. And thank you so much. I just wish that you all take care of yourself, be safe at home, be quarantined, follow social distancing, follow the orders passed by the government so that we are not prosecuted under 188, as Mr. Shadman Siddiqui asked me. So take care of yourself, and I'll see you again. Thank you. All the best. Take care.